just a tap away.
Now turn the heat up in this kitchen like yum, yum, yum. We can boogie. Yum, yum, yum. And we'll be cooking all night.
Tomorrow, National Geographic will be looking back at 20 years of history, starting at 8 with the 80s, the decade that made us. Then at 9, we move forward 10 years to the 90s, the decade that connected us.
The County of Essex, northeast of London, once the land of open space and opportunity. By the mid-1990s, it had become a war zone.
Gangsters against gangsters. That's how this business works. If you do someone a bad deed, they're going to come back and do you one.
Gang warfare poisoned the dream as organised crime spilled out of London's East End into the fields, beaches, streets and nightclubs of Essex.
We're talking guns, knives or whatever you need to win. There was going to be a war.
It's a story that's now hit the big screen. But in this programme, for the first time, is told by the men who had their fingers on the triggers.
Just empty the gun into them and go bang, 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 bang.
They reveal how sex, drugs and rock and roll fueled the fight for the new criminal frontier in the new towns of Essex.
Evolution of drugs, evolution of music was always going to overtake us. It was just a flood of villainy with violence.
And how four decades of vice and murder culminated in one of the most infamous gangland killings in underworld history.
They were the worst of the worst. Couldn't afford to take chances with them. They had to go.
One winter's night in 1995, three gangsters drove down a country lane in the village of Rettenden. They were the notorious Essex Boys, and they were falling into a trap. Their reign as one of Britain's most ruthless drug gangs was about to end. Within minutes, all three men were gunned down in a violent ambush.
He shot Rolf behind the ear, he shot Tucker in the side of the face, and then he shot Tate in the liver.
The next morning, Rettenden awoke to a horrific crime scene. And the Essex Boys were destined to go down in underworld legend.
Detectives believe the killings have all the hallmarks of a gangland murder.
As the media feasted on the story, it emerged that areas of Essex were in the grip of a violent drugs war, waged by bloodthirsty gangs.
The dirty business of drugs in Essex overtook most counties. If you start dealing with drugs in back alleys, in farm tracks, you're probably not going to drive out of there. And that is what Essex became.
The Essex Boys' brutal end epitomised the county's plight as gangster battled gangster and created a living nightmare for police. Danny Woolard is a veteran of the Essex underworld. Since the 60s, he's made a fortune from robberies and now lives on a piece of prime Essex real estate.
Leave off, oi!
He witnessed brutal drug wars transform the county.
The only people who make a living are drug dealers. I don't like drug dealers, I wouldn't deal with it. I don't trust them for one thing. I wouldn't trust them. And they've not done their apprenticeship. They do a couple of drug deals and they're villains.
Woolard is part of the criminal old school whose violence built gangland Essex. Like many successful criminals, he grew up in London's East End, which in the 1960s was a hotbed of organised crime. Woolard had a reputation for violence, and in the East End, that was a valuable commodity. He was employed by gangsters to force businesses to pay protection money. Amongst those paying for his services were the notorious Cray twins. Ken Tappenden joined the regional crime squad covering London and the surrounding counties and was targeting the Cray's extortion rackets.
If you didn't pay them to look after you, then they actually damaged you. It's as simple as that. That's how extortion works. They were the people to catch.
In 1969, the police crackdown sent shockwaves through the underworld when the Krays were jailed for life. For years, they'd seemed untouchable, but their very public murder of two East End gangsters signalled the end of their empire. With the police on their trail, criminals were facing extinction. To survive, they fled the overcrowded and overpoliced East End. They needed a new home, and they knew just where to look.
EastEnders always looked to Essex as a place to get away to. It's always where you wanted to go, a weekend away. So there has always been this thing about getting away to Essex.
60 times the size of the East End, it had everything they could wish for. Miles of unguarded coastline. A new generation of criminals emerged in Essex, ruthless in their determination to follow in the footsteps of the Krays and become kings of this new underworld.
People like the Blundell family, they actually stepped into their shoes. And I say that they were more dangerous in the way they thought, the way they operated, the way they undertook their criminality than ever the Krays would have been.
Billy Blundell was one of the most powerful figures in the Essex underworld.
The worst thing you can ever do in a criminal fraternity is be successful.
A policeman's son, Blundell had also grown up in the East End. With his brother Eddie, he got rich selling ice cream, as the capital's swinging image attracted unprecedented numbers of tourists. But the Blundells were men of violence, and any competition were literally beaten off.
I've had more fights on the cobbles than I ever did in a boxing ring. But it was the norm. We didn't think it was, you know, there'd be loads of tourists about, a bit of fun for them.
By the 1970s, the Blundells' ruthless approach to business had made them a lot of money. Billy Blundell could now afford the Essex life he couldn't get in the East End.
It was my dream to buy a small holding and build a house there and have a lake and stables, and that's what I did. I had my dream come true.
Now that he had a foothold, Blundell was ready to expand his empire. The bloody battle for the Essex underworld was about to begin, and it started in a remote field. In the summer of 1971, the county was in a celebratory mood. 150,000 people flocked to the quiet village of Wheely in North Essex for a pop festival featuring stars like T-Rex and Rod Stewart. The Blundells were running catering and brought their own security. Other traders knew they had to pay them a cut or pay the consequences. But as the event got underway, the brothers realised they weren't the only violent gang in town.
The Hells Angels turned up, about 200 of them on motorbikes and all that, and just pushing the workers off and just helping themselves out those and hamburgers, and they were powerless to stop them, you know.
The fearsome Hells Angels were bad for business, and Billy knew they had to be dealt with.
At that time, it was like hippies and all that, you know, and overnight everybody was walking around with these ponchos on, had some ponchos, you know. So we all did the same, but underneath our ponchos we had pickaxe handles and bricks and all sorts of things. And what we was doing, we was going in little crews, coming out the crowds, setting about, giving it to them, then moving on, so they didn't know where it was coming from, you know.
The hard face of Hard Rock had met their match, and eventually police took the Hells Angels away for their own protection. Billy Blundell was establishing himself in Essex, but he was fighting battles on many fronts, and this got him noticed. Later that year, the violence spilled out onto the streets during a feud with a rival gang.
Ilford High Road was quite busy, and all hell broke loose, basically, because I'm firing in the street, people are running for cover, went on and on, you know.
Blundell was arrested and charged with attempted murder. In court, one detective came under attack from an unlikely member of Blundell's family, his mum.
She said, "You bastard," she said, "you're always picking on my boys, all the time." He said, "Mrs. Blundell, I'm not picking on your boys at all. Your son shot three people in Ilford High Road in front of witnesses." She said, "You bloody liar." She said, "My boys are good boys, I don't do them things. So you can't do no wrong in your mum's eyes, you know."
He did no wrong in the jury's eyes either. They found he'd acted in self-defense. It would be another 11 years and 13 trials before the law finally caught up with Billy Blundell. But while Blundell fought on the streets and fields, on the coast, a new type of crime was emerging. Essex was a gateway to Europe, and at ports such as Tilbury, millions of pounds worth of goods were loaded onto lorries every day. On the open roads, trucks had always been vulnerable to hijackers. Now, enterprising criminals bought farmland in the countryside and rented out barns for hijackers to store their stolen goods. The barns became known as slaughters because of the way the trucks were stripped to the bone.
Lorry loads of whiskey, gin, whatever you wanted to say went off the roads, and that turned out to be the next area of crime. They run it into a slaughter and you wouldn't find it for months.
Experian know life is full of important steps. And now, Experian Credit Matcher helps you take a next step towards financial control. First, get your Experian credit score free forever. Then use Credit Matcher to find credit cards and loans you're more likely to be accepted for. Take the guesswork out of searching for credit cards and loans at experian.co.uk.
We at Bosch believe that for perfect washing results, you have to dose very precisely. Or not at all. iDOS from Bosch. Fill it up once and it doses automatically. Wash after wash. Bosch, invented for life.
The SsangYong Tivoli comes with a 5-year limitless mileage warranty. Heated leather seats. 7-inch screen with reversing camera. It was chosen by Auto Express as the cheapest SUV to run. And now with 3 years free servicing.
Register today at Elite Singles and benefit from 100% verified profiles, an extensive personality test and tailored matches. EliteSingles.co.uk.
Don't miss an extra 10% off in the Harveys up to 50% event. This fabric three-seater sofa, just $449. Or this leather recliner sofa, only $629. Or this comfy fabric three-seater sofa, just $719. Plus, there's up to 4 years interest-free credit on everything. Hurry, an extra 10% off must end Tuesday.
Guinness has always been about beer and people. And many of us have entered these gates in the footsteps of our parents and grandparents. 258 years ago, we signed a 9,000-year lease. We have a lot more beer to make.
The Beatles Vinyl Collection. 23 original albums on vinyl. Own this unmissable collection of iconic albums from one of the greatest bands of all time. Issue 1 out now with your first album, Abbey Road, Finder and Magazine for just $9.99. D'Agostini.
Right now, the world's looking for UK suppliers of fashion and textiles.
Water sports equipment.
Console games.
Rail construction projects.
Food and drink.
In Norway.
Thailand.
Lithuania.
Kenya.
France. The opportunities for UK businesses
are enormous.
So come on.
Why not open your doors to 7 billion potential customers?
The planet needs the UK's expertise.
The demand
is out here.
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 Here. Here.
You should be too.
When you're buying a new car, you want to be sure you're getting a good deal. CarWow could save you thousands. Search CarWow and try it today.
Suspense in every moment. 888 Casino. Join and get up to £888 free.
It's that time of year. The excitement is in the air. And one night isn't enough. You want more. And we've got it. Big Cats. 7 premieres. You're welcome. Big Cat Week. All next week. Only on Nat Geo Wild.
Gangland Essex was evolving. And in the quiet fields and farmland, criminal networks had started to take root. The pioneers had laid the foundations for a new underworld. And from the start of the 80s, that meant drugs.
With drugs, what you want is a slice of the market. You don't have to live in a particular territory in order to dominate it. So Essex became viable because in Essex, you've got the coast, you've got fields, you've got barns. So Essex became an ideal venue for the new market that was typified by drugs.
For the next 20 years, the Essex underworld would tear itself apart in a bloody battle to control the drug trade. Profits were huge, and the marketplace full of ruthless criminals.
Billy Blundell now lives in rural Essex. He's a wealthy man and enjoys pottering around on his farm.
Hello, boy.
In 1983, shortly after appearing in a TV documentary, Billy Blundell was arrested on his Essex farm for conspiracy to manufacture amphetamines.
The Crown said the drugs were worth nearly £1 million on the black market. They said Blundell was the gang's Mr. Big. The judge described him as an evil man.
To this day, Blundell protests his innocence.
I rented them a house that I owned, which they used. Although I knew what they was doing, I wasn't a part of their conspiracy. They got raided by the police, and the police put me up as the Mr. Big in the background. There you go, Prince Philip would have got found guilty.
At Chelmsford Crown Court, Blundell got 8 years jail for conspiring to run an illicit amphetamine factory.
So that was number 13. I'd had 12 not guilties on the trot over the previous 20 years. I was charged with attempted murder on a couple of occasions that I got out of. But all the things that I got found not guilty was, some of them were a little bit near the mark, so although I got 8 years for something I didn't do, I'm not too bitter because it's sod's law, I'm paying for yesterday.
After the guilty verdict, speculation was rife. Why had Blundell purchased his Essex farm? An associate of the man who'd sold the farm had his own theory.
Mr. Blundell wanted that house because it had a big garden with the lake in it, and he wanted that lake for drug smuggling. With other words, aeroplanes could fly over and drop the drug.
This claim was never proven and is denied by Blundell. But one thing was clear, the demand for recreational drugs was booming. And for criminals, that meant big business. In the mid-80s, an underground youth movement became a cultural phenomenon, and it would change the Essex underworld forever.
The 1980s was quite important, and drug use started to go mainstream. And ecstasy use really was the trigger for that.
Ecstasy, the so-called love drug, also known as E, gave users energy. Young people wanted to dance till dawn, and overnight, a new drug epidemic took hold.
You could not dance for 15 hours with a bottle of pop and still have a happy face unless you scoffed ease. I guarantee to you. So we knew something was happening.
A pioneer of the new movement was Andrew Pritchard.
The rave scene came about in my very, very late teens, early 20s. A new music had emerged on the scene, known as acid house, and a drug had emerged also called ecstasy.
Pritchard began staging illegal parties, which attracted thousands of people to warehouses and open spaces in London and Essex. He didn't pay for the premises, he just turned up, took over, and charged admission. While he didn't provide the ecstasy, Pritchard knew his events depended on the drug.
Without it, there wouldn't have been no parties, and the parties would have been very lame. As they say, if there wasn't a drug dealer in the venue, we'd have to go out and find one. Otherwise, the party would be dead.
People wanted to party, and Pritchard made it happen. He mobilised legions of revellers to descend upon unsuspecting villages in their thousands. Under pressure from horrified communities, Thatcher's government needed to appear strong. The conservative media joined in the fight. National radio banned acid house music, and newspapers ran sensational headlines. The government tasked Ken Tappenden with the tough job of breaking up the party.
The organisers were better than we were. I only wish I had them as my lieutenants, because they were brilliant. They could organise thousands of people in 2 hours to go from one spot to another. The military can't do that now. The police definitely couldn't do it.
Broadcasting on pirate radio and using newly available mobile phones, Pritchard kept one step ahead of Tappenden's pay party unit. Essex was ideally situated for the raves. Drugs came in from the coast, and in the open fields and derelict buildings, Thatcher's generation parted. Pritchard's illegal events company, Genesis, was going from strength to strength.
The admission would be between £10 and £20 a ticket. You could probably, out of a good event, maybe take 70 to 100 grand in a large warehouse.
By the age of 22, Andrew Pritchard had made his first million.
It was a MTV pop style lifestyle. It was great. The cars, you know, the clothes, the jewellery, the women, you know, you had a great life. And, you know, every 21-year-old wants to do that.
But you couldn't make this kind of profit without the underworld taking notice. And in the 1980s, armed robbers began to realise there were easier ways of making money than holding up banks.
They knew that if they carried on armed robberies, they're going to get banged up. They're going to get shot on the plot.
To avoid police marksmen, robbers looked for a softer target, and raves were easy pickings.
You didn't see a bank robbery all the time you had acid parties? Never. You didn't have to. If they could go to half a dozen parties on a Friday, Saturday night and walk off with a couple of £100,000, as they did, easy money, isn't it?
Pritchard was taking massive amounts of cash, kept not in vaults and safes, but bin liners and sports bags.
Back then we were wide open, basically. We were vulnerable to all sorts of undesirables. So the choice we had to make was to get the right people to protect us and work with those people in order for our parties to succeed.
The raves were illegal. Pritchard couldn't go to the police or legitimate security firms, so instead, he looked for people with violent reputations. They weren't hard to find. West Ham United was the traditional football club of the East End. For the displaced Londoners in Essex, Upton Park Stadium was a symbol of their old heritage. It's peaceful nowadays, but in the 1980s, it was under siege. Every weekend, rival firms of football hooligans orchestrated violence on the terraces. With long-term hooligan Carlton Leach at its heart, West Ham's Intercity firm, or ICF, were the most notorious. Football violence was nothing new, but the ICF were different. Embodying the spirit of the age, they were upwardly mobile and ambitious. They were once described as Thatcher's Eagles.
You want to be the best, don't you? We all want to be. You want to be tops in life, whatever it is.
They're incredibly sharp and entrepreneurial, and they saw this as an opportunity. Rather than whacking other football fans at the weekend for nothing, they thought, well, if we're going to use muscle and we're going to use reputation, we might just as well get paid for it, which is what they did.
The ICF soon evolved from football hooligans to security entrepreneurs, bouncers and doormen. In the decades that followed, some of them would help to bring violence and bloodshed to gangland Essex. But in 1988, rave organiser Andrew Pritchard simply wanted to protect his profits, and Leach was about to get a piece of the action.
There was a rave thing called Genesis, and did we want to do the supply and security for it? £250 a night. What?
Leach already had a part-time job as a doorman, but he'd never seen anything like the raves.
We was used to sort of like 100, 200 people in a club. You get quite a lot of trouble when it comes down to drink. And then we're in a warehouse and there's like thousands of people queuing up, people coming in, and it was like just madness.
The architects of the love drug culture were now in bed with men of violence. As far as Tappenden was concerned, Pritchard and his friends were in too deep.
They weren't hard men. They were Jack the Lad. They'd been to Ibiza. They'd stripped down, not worn a shirt for 3 months, liked a bit of money, got with the girls, had a few drugs. They weren't villains, but they were mad to carry on with it, because when the gangsters got into it, you knew then that we were in big trouble.
As profits soared, the ICF tried to take over and began to demand an ever-increasing share of the proceeds.
We started off on wages and then they decided to give us a cut because it was getting so busy that we got a percentage of the door.
In Leach's view, this wasn't extortion, simply an arrangement that worked for both parties.
To bring us on board as a partner was quite a clever move by Andrew and the boys, because that made us part of it. So you're not going to destroy your own thing, you're not going to ruin your own thing, and you're now part of it. I think it was like quarter partners or something like that, it worked out, so whatever it was. But you're not going to mess up your own thing.
There's a very fine line between security and extortion. It's a difficult line to draw between actually you pay me for stopping trouble in your club, or if you don't pay me, there will be trouble in your club.
We kind of inadvertently had brought back the protection rackets through the parties. Extortion, in actual fact, in enforcement, became a business again.
Tappenden believed that firms like the ICF had also muscled in on the drugs trade at the events.
You're never going to argue with 10 real good bouncers who are good villains, GBH merchants, attempt murder merchants. You're not going to argue with them when they got a Rottweiler dog on the end of a leash.
The rave scene was descending further and further into the underworld. Tappenden now had Pritchard firmly in his sights. If he mixed with gangsters, he had to be taken down.
They got the mad notion one day to set riot squads out for us. Now, when you've got a riot squad of aggressive police who turn up in SPG vans with helmets and shields, you can have a big problem in your hands, because not only have you got maybe 12 or 15 strong doormen who are going to be your first port of entry who are going to try to stop you, you've got 4,000 or 5,000 people behind now who are also going to be extremely pissed off.
In 3 violent months, the Pay Party unit made 265 arrests and recovered chilling proof that gangsters had infected the rave scene. To avoid the heat, Pritchard slipped quietly out of the country, but the Essex underworld had not seen the last of him.
Upgrade to Sky Q and we'll provide you with our next generation box. You can record way more than before, 4 shows while you watch a 5th. Store over 1,000 hours of your favourite TV, watch recordings from your main box all around the house, and take recordings anywhere, even offline. Phew! And that's just some of the things you can do with Sky Q. Call us or search Sky Q to upgrade from only £12 extra a month.
With Expedia, when you book your flights and hotel together, you can often save money.
At all protected.
Oh, there's Wi-Fi fuel.
There's Scouts on Wi-Fi?
Yeah, there's lots.
Password?
Corsair 2017.
It's a capital C.
It's a capital C.
Vauxhall Corsair with 4G Wi-Fi. For only £172 per month plus advance rental. Always get a great reception. Corsair from Vauxhall.
At E.ON, we're always coming up with new ways to make our customers' lives that little bit easier.
Oh, yeah? Like what?
Well, our wind farms now power over 700,000 homes in the UK.
Great.
Sorry about the mess.
And now you can pay your bill with just a few taps.
I like it, but what about something to make life easier right now?
Energy meters that can read themselves?
Bye-bye, back of the cupboard. Hello, self-reading smart meters from E.ON.
You brush your teeth every day, but wouldn't you feel better if you could see and feel it cleaning? Colgate Total Proof. It turns into a blue foam as you brush, fights bacteria, and reduces plaque. So you feel ready for your day. Colgate Total Proof for a healthier mouth.
Assassin's Creed, the official collection. Enter the secret world of the Brotherhood with high-quality hand-painted figurines. Issue 1, just $2.99.
What if technology gave us the power to turn this enemy into an ally?
Microsoft and its partners are using smart traps to capture mosquitoes and sequence their DNA to fight disease. There are over 100 million pieces of DNA in every sample. With the Microsoft Cloud, we can analyze the data faster than ever before. If we can detect new viruses before they spread, we may someday prevent outbreaks before they begin.
You know that moment in life when you fit perfectly in every situation? You could be playing in a band or dancing swing. You could be dressed like this. Hold on. Those shoes? Yes. Or how about this? Go, go, go! Right now, this could be happening to you. And this too. Impressive. The new award-winning Seat Leon. Book a test drive and get an extra 500 pounds off any new Seat.
Seat.
We came to give India back her freedom, not to tear apart.
It's a must-see. An incredible true story. Viceroy's House. In cinemas Friday.
They daydream of the night before. See what happens when the sun goes down. Brand new Africa's Hunters, Monday at 8 on Nat Geo Wild.
Ken Tappenden retired from the police force in 1993. The war on drugs had been his last stand. He always felt it was a losing battle.
You never win. Why on earth I turned out 600 policemen some nights, I don't know. Evolution of villainy, evolution of drugs, evolution of music was always going to overtake us. All we did for a while was put the sandbags across the door, and when you took that off, it was just a flood of villainy with violence.
In the 1990s, the underground rave scene exploded onto the mainstream stage. While the government introduced new laws to tackle the warehouse parties, giving police the upper hand, new licensing laws meant Essex nightclubs could stay open late. Keen to cash in on the music's popularity, clubs began to stage legal rave nights of their own. But with raves came drugs, and with the drugs came a bloody gang war. The battlefield would be Basildon, the new town that 50 years earlier had embodied optimism and a bright future. It was this town that gave birth to a gang destined to go down in underworld legend as the infamous Essex Boys. Their leader was Tony Tucker, a security entrepreneur who, like Carlton Leach and the ICF before him, controlled the drugs trade as gatekeeper to the ecstasy-fueled raves. Tucker supplied security for popular Basildon night spot Raquel's. His head doorman was violent offender Bernard O'Mahony. He knew Tucker's dealers and allowed them into the club.
Obviously, at the front here, you'd have all the doormen. They might pretend to search them if the police were here or management were here, and then let them upstairs to sell their wares, basically.
Tucker's approved dealers could operate without interference, and now that drugs, not alcohol, fueled the party, violence became a rare occurrence, which meant the authorities stayed away.
The police just left us to it, really. They used to drive by and wave and, all right, lads, and there was no trouble at all, you know what I mean? We were just left to our own devices, you know what I mean? The lunatics took over the asylum, you know what I mean?
The dealers were getting rich and paid Tony Tucker handsomely for protection within the club. Tucker had quickly become a powerful player and believed he could control the new Essex rave scene. With his newfound wealth and status, he bought expensive property in rural Essex and rubbed shoulders with celebrities. He was personal-minded to middleweight boxing champion Nigel Benn. The other two members of the Essex Boys were brutal henchman Craig Rolfe and ambitious villain Pat Tate, a giant with a big personality and a huge ambition.
He was awesome, a big man, 6'4", good-looking man, he had loads of character, charisma. You know, you could just had everything that anyone wanted, you know what I mean?
But entrepreneur Tate always wanted more.
Tate, this big monster, and he was saying to Tucker, you know, forget selling pills in clubs. You're only making a couple of grand a week or this. He said, I can make you big money.
The Essex drugs market was huge. Ecstasy use was more widespread than ever. But criminals were turning over fortunes from drugs of every description. Cocaine, heroin, and cannabis were rife.
Drugs started to take over from every other form of making money with villainy. In a big way.
Tate saw an opportunity for aggressive expansion. The gang began moving in on other drug businesses. They wanted a larger share of the market and were prepared to use force to take it. On one occasion, the gang tried to take a cut of the profit from a cannabis growing operation. What they didn't know was that veteran crook Danny Woolard already had money invested in it.
Me and my country club, me and my mate, so you ain't getting nothing. And they didn't want to know. They were bullies where they could be, my opinion. When you bully people, yeah, whatever's coming, didn't they?
Woolard's associates left Tate with a broken jaw. He hoped that this would teach the gang a valuable lesson about upsetting fellow criminals.
If you keep catching people and having them over, you're going to get shot or done or something, isn't it? You can't carry on like that.
But the Essex boys didn't learn their lesson. They were out of control. They weren't just dealing drugs. They'd also become heavy users, and friends noticed their behaviour changing.
It'd gone beyond the realm of just taking a pill and going out and dancing or, you know, the rave. It was going every hardcore drugs, you know what I mean? And they were different people. They were strangers.
Crazed by drug use and a thirst to expand their business, the gang were ruthless to their enemies and associates alike.
People messed up. The way Tony and Pat were is they had to be punished, you know.
When a small-time seller who worked for them lost money on a drug deal, Tucker and Rolf made him pay with his life. He was kidnapped and, according to O'Mahony, given the gang's signature treatment.
He used to get a syringe and put steroids in it and other drugs, heroin and things like that, and they used to call it champagne.
The victim was forcibly injected, the cocktail was lethal, and he died a horrible death. The message was clear, the gang were not to be crossed.
And when Rolf went to the back of the car to throw him out of the car, they discovered he was dead. They just threw him in the ditch like discarded rubbish.
Word of their brutality quickly spread throughout the underworld. But in Essex at that time, police described a curtain of fear and no one was talking to them. For victims caught up in drugs, the last place you could turn was the police. With the authorities unable to act, it fell to the old criminal establishment to worry about the underworld's new upstarts. Now free after serving his time for the amphetamine conviction, Billy Blundell was not impressed.
Injecting people up and throwing them in ditches to die and things like that, which they did, you know, so they were the worst of the worst. So, you know, you couldn't afford to take chances with them. They had to go.
The Essex boys were making enemies in high places, but one victim would fight back. Pat Tate had begun using heavy drugs, and when his close friend Steve Nipper Ellis confronted him about it, it provoked a bitter feud.
We had this massive argument, and I just remember saying, Pat, you're nothing but a junkie, you're nothing more than a junkie. And he's gone, Nipper, I control the drugs, drugs don't control me, I mean, you're a junkie, you're nothing more than a junkie.
But what Nipper Ellis didn't realise was that in their drug-addled state, Tate and Tucker were looking for any excuse to turn on him.
When they used to come in the club, I could sort of see that there was ill feeling from Tucker towards Nipper.
When Ellis made an offhand remark about Tony Tucker's girlfriend, they had their excuse. Tucker and his henchman Craig Rolf turned the torture treatment on Ellis.
So I'm doing the hoovering in the hall, front door's opened, in walks Tony. He's grabbed me by the throat and he's sort of lifting me up, pushed me down onto the bed, and he's sat across me and he pulled out a meat cleaver. And I'm looking at him and he's going, your hand or your foot? And I was just thinking, if you cut my foot off, I won't be able to chase you. If you cut my hand off, I can still shoot you. And I'm left-handed, so I held out my right hand and I just sat there, closed my eyes, thought I'm going to scream, I'm going to cry, it's going to hurt, but I'm going to kill you.
Tucker allowed Nipper to keep his hand, but he left the flat with many of his belongings, while Rolf wiped excrement over the walls. High on drugs, the gang had become monsters. In the days that followed, the gang decided they had let Ellis off lightly. Tucker and Tate told friends they now planned to torture and kill him. But when the gang threatened his family, Ellis decided to strike first. He went to Pat Tate's Basildon home to murder his former friend.
Come up into his back garden, I had the handgun, and I just thought, I'm going to shoot him, simple as that, I'm going to shoot him. Picked a rock up, threw the rock through the frosted glass, since the glass broke, there was Pat, and he's having a shave, and he's looked like that. What had happened is the gun hadn't fired properly, it had gone click, click, bang, and the third bullet hit him in the arm. All I could hear was screaming, and Pat was on the phone going, "Please, please, I've been shot.
Ellis escaped, and Tate was taken to hospital. But the Essex boys had been attacked and wouldn't take it lying down. They drew up a plan to lure Nipper Ellis to the hospital, promising a truce. Tate hid a weapon in the bedsheets and waited for Ellis to arrive.
But fortunately for Nipper, and unfortunately for Tate, fortunately for everyone else, a nurse making up Tate's bed found the gun, called the police, and he was recalled to prison.
Pat Tate had been on parole for a robbery, but possessing a firearm breached his conditions and he was sent back to jail for 18 months. Tate refused to give evidence against Ellis, but the gang had threatened his family and Ellis's war with the Essex boys was only just beginning.
I had to kill them. That was all I knew. I just lived to kill them.
While in jail, Pat Tate was filmed for a news item about the prison gym. But while playing the model prisoner, he was busy planning his drugs empire. Tate decided that away from the raves, the Essex boys could be making much more money with much less risk.
The trouble is with the rave scene. If you have 500 ecstasy pills, it's no good sitting in the corner of the club with them in a bag and not telling anyone about it. You have to approach as many people as possible to sell as many as you can. And the more people you tell, the more chance you are of being grassed up. So Tate, in his infinite wisdom, thought that was a bad idea.
Tate wanted to move up the underworld ladder and into importing drugs. With the longest coastline of any county and major ports like Tilbury to exploit, it was possible to make a lot of money from smuggling drugs in Essex. Pat Tate set his sights on going global. Today Basildon, tomorrow the world. On Halloween night 1995, he was released from prison.
If you were a rational person and you're dealing with international criminals and heavy duty criminals, not a problem. But if you're a homicidal maniac man mountain, not a good idea because you're going to upset people.
The gang began importing drugs from the continent. But on November the 11th, 1995, came the event that would mark the beginning of the end. A teenager called Leah Betts fell into a coma after taking a single ecstasy pill. The tablet had been bought at Raquel's, putting the club firmly under the national media spotlight.
Raquel's was being named as the source of the drugs, so I just knew this was going to cause murders, you know what I mean? Or mayhem.
The mainstream drug scene now had a high-profile victim, and the press were demanding answers. What happened behind the doors of Raquel's was now a matter of nationwide public interest.
Rang Tucker and he just went off the edge, you know what I mean? They're going to be trying importing drugs while under the media spotlight, you know what I mean?
The party was over. Police were now all over the club, warning customers about drugs and determined to discover how an 18-year-old girl had been supplied with ecstasy.
The stage was set, really. Tate was threatening everyone and everything that moves because his plans to be an international drug smuggler were falling apart.
Unable to do business, they pressurised and threatened their underworld partners for money. Then, as Leah Betts lay dying, O'Mahony says the police came to see him. He was about to have to decide whose side he was on.
They said, "We're trying to get one of the pills that she'd taken from that batch so we can analyse it and he might be able to help." And I said, "I'll get you one." Tucker went mental. He went, "You can't be dealing with the police." And I sat at home, and I've got kids, you know what I mean? And I sat there and I thought, well, what's more important? You know, some drug dealer or an 18-year-old girl. There was no choice. I didn't even think about it. Oh, do you know what I mean? I just thought, I'll get one.
To the Essex boys, this was a clear act of betrayal. Domino Mahoney was now a marked man and learned from police that the gang were coming after him.
So I got my then partner and two kids and I put them in an hotel at a place called Rettenden. And we stayed there the night.
O'Mahony wasn't the only one under threat. Raquel's regular drug dealer owed the Essex boys money. But with police all over the club, he couldn't work and he couldn't pay his debt. When the Essex boys threatened him and his family, he turned to the one man in Essex he knew could help him.
I said to him, yeah, it can be sorted out. I said, I'll make a phone call now and get it sorted out for you. I made a phone call and a guy turned up on a motorbike with a crash helmet with a 9mm gun.
Lundell provided the terrified dealer with the gun, the chaperone and some simple advice.
When they turn up, shoot one of them straight in the cobblers. You ain't gonna kill him, just shoot him straight in the cobblers. Or even both of them.
The dealer declined this helpful offer. Instead, Blundell called the Essex boys to a meeting. Only Tate turned up, and Blundell took the chance to warn him that his association with Tucker was dangerous.
He didn't seem to care much, and I said to him, you know, it's all right, him keep blanking and all that, but what happens if someone creeps up behind him and goes bang in the back of the head? If you're with him, you're going to get it as well. You know what I mean? I said, well, if it happens, it happens. 3 days later, it happened.
What is a journalist's job? To tell the story from every side. Oh, hello. The rule is, you just keep going unless someone stops you. What's the story here?
They could kill us.
They won't. I'm a stranger in a strange land.
Are you endangering yourself by talking to me?
Well, I'm prepared to pay the price.
Time is running out.
Definitely a story worth telling.
Brand new, uncensored with Michael Ware, begins with Putin's biker gangs. Starts 13th of March on National Geographic.
She makes a sound, the sound.
Oh, come on. You make me look like such a clown.
But it's thanks to you she fell for me. Thank you, Immaturity.
Find your next date at our Match cooking classes. Match. Love your imperfections.
Hair is the first thing people see.
It's a huge part of who I am.
It can be really striking. It can be a game changer as well.
Each time you dye your hair, you always have a worry that you're going to damage it.
I've used Olia for 3 years.
A year.
Four.
I was 9 months pregnant. I had roots down to here. I was out here.
Using Olia was just a moment, a ray of sunshine.
My hair felt really soft and like it had been massively conditioned.
The fact that it doesn't have ammonia, I needed something that would be quite gentle.
It's very floral and fruity.
Gets rid of all the grey hair and it keeps it really silky.
You can't tell, thank goodness, that I've abused my hair pretty badly for a long time.
I just love the vivid colour.
My mum loves it and she's probably my harshest critic. Look at my hair, everyone.
60% oil powered, no ammonia. Now it's your turn to fall in love with Olia. Discover our stories at garnier.co.uk. Olia by Garnier.
Join the co-op and every mouthful,
bye,
every flavour packed, fair trade, British, an all-day longed-for mouthful of co-op food earns you 5% back and 1% back for your community. Great food, fairly priced, and just down the road.
My Little Pony Colouring Adventures. Every week you can collect a magical story and colouring book and build the ultimate colour creativity kit. Issue 1, 99p. Out now.
The truth about aging. Not all wrinkles are the same.
Some wrinkles, like the vertical ones, make you look sad.
Revitalift Anti-Wrinkle and Extra Firming Cream by L'Oreal, the world's number one for anti-aging.
It works.
Enriched with pro-retinol, the formula helps reduce the appearance of wrinkles. Skin feels firmer.
I can see a difference here and here.
Now introducing new Revitalift Radiance SPF 20. Target wrinkles and unveil your glow. Exclusively at Superdrug. Revitalift, now better than half price.
Experian know life is full of important steps. And now, Experian Credit Matcher helps you take a next step towards financial control. First, get your Experian credit score free forever. Then use Credit Matcher to find credit cards and loans you're more likely to be accepted for. Take the guesswork out of searching for credit cards and loans at experian.co.uk.
The Dyson V8 cord-free vacuum has twice the suction of others. To clean here, up here, and here. Because the Dyson digital motor is in here. And you only get that from Dyson. Twice the suction of any other cordless vacuum.
We're missing doors, we're missing boot, we're missing wheels, we're missing lights.
There's only one thing left to do.
Let's get started.
Shift out of the way, we're coming through.
This car is the biggest mistake we've ever made. Ooh.
Brand new Car SOS starts the 16th of March on National Geographic.
It's all right.
They were found in this Range Rover.
All three men were shot through the head at point-blank range. Detectives believe the killings have all the hallmarks of a gangland murder.
You have 26 messages.
Charlie's Colton, can you give us a ring? Cheers, mate.
Tom, can you ring us back? If he's dead. We're worried. Will you ring us straight back as soon as you can?
Hi, it's Annie May. Can you just give us a ring, please? Let us know you're alright. Because at the moment, I think you're dead.
On the night of December the 6th, 1995, the gang were lured to this remote country lane, where they were ambushed by two mystery gunmen. O'Mahony thinks he knows how it went down.
The front of the car was adjacent to this tree. The vehicle stopped and there was a 5-bar gate there. And the fourth man in the vehicle said, wait here, I've got the key. As he's kneeling down by the gate, pretending to unlock it, the fifth man was lying over there in the undergrowth. He came to the back of the car. So he shot Rolf behind the ear. He was killed instantly. His hands remain on the steering wheel. His foot's on the brake. His shot took her in the side of the face. That exits through his mouth. It doesn't cause any damage to any vital organs, so he's still alive and moaning. And then he shot Tate in the liver. So they can have words with him before they finally kill him. Another man goes around the back of the car and shoots Tate through the near side window. After shooting Tate the second time, they shot Tucker again, behind the ear, and they're all dead. The gunmen just turn and walk away, back up the lane to meet the getaway vehicle.
The gunman and the getaway driver escaped, and for 6 months, their identities remained a mystery.
People said to me, who do you think killed? And the police, I said, well, open the Essex phone book and put your finger in. Everyone in there has got a reason, you know what I mean?
So who shot the Essex boys? They'd made many enemies. Danny Woolard had crossed swords with the gang in the past. Was he the Rettenden assassin?
I was here that night. It was nothing to do with me. I was in the burnt mill service station going to nick a lorry.
The tiny village was busy that night. Nipper Ellis was also in town. He'd tried before to kill them. Was he there to finish the job?
Me and somebody else, we were trying to thieve a container with some stuff in it. So I was up near Rettenden. Unfortunately, I didn't hear the shots. I'd like to say I was there, but I was up near Rettenden.
By morning, O'Mahony had checked out of the village hotel. He knew the gang were out to get him. Had he got to them first?
When I got off the train at a place called Southminster, the platform was just loads of police officers. And I thought, these ain't come to check my ticket, do you know what I mean?
Convinced the police would come for him too, Billy Blundell decided to take a holiday.
The newspapers were full of it about Bob Hoskin lookalike who drives a red Rolls Royce, and in the paper said drives around with men with no necks and all this load of nonsense.
But the police didn't come for Blundell. In fact, All four men are innocent of the murders. Someone else killed the Essex boys. In May 1996, police were handed a breakthrough when a suspect in a drugs raid turned informant and claimed to be the getaway driver. On his evidence, Michael Steele and Jack Womes were convicted of murdering the Essex boys. Steele had been a big-time drug smuggler, one of many people the gang had threatened. Womes was his accomplice. The two men are now serving life sentences, though the underworld believes that the authorities have the wrong men.
They didn't do it. You know, the guy who put them there had something to gain by doing that. So...
It wasn't him. They're innocent men, mate. They're innocent. Believe me.
I know who was there that night, and I know they weren't there.
Veterans of the Essex underworld know to stay silent, but they also hope that with the gang gone, Essex could look forward to a brighter future.
It's sad that three people died, but whoever did it, you know, did the world a favour, really, because their intent in killing me and killing other people. So good riddance to bad rubbish, really.
15 years on from the fall of the Essex boys, Billy Blundell believes the county is worse than ever. He's retired from crime and now runs a boxing gym, hoping to keep kids off the streets. When he thinks things are bad, you know you're in trouble.
A lot of these young kids run around with guns. We really shouldn't have a bow and arrow in our hands, or anything else, you know.
And as for Essex, the land of opportunity, it continues to be plagued by drugs. In 2004, £100 million worth of cocaine was smuggled through Tilbury Docks. The man the authorities suspected, the man charged with Britain's biggest ever cocaine bust, was Andrew Pritchard. If convicted, Pritchard faced 40 years in prison. Though he admits to a lucrative career as a smuggler, he denies he ever smuggled cocaine. He has always claimed he was set up by customs and excise. After two trials, he was acquitted of all charges. Though he spent 18 months on remand, for an entrepreneur like Pritchard, everything is an opportunity. He has written a book, and a film about his career is underway. By cashing in on his past criminal career, Pritchard is not alone. The Rettenden shootings have spawned three feature films and several books in just 15 years. The old kings of the underworld are swapping their guns for their pens, to the despair of police.
I thought the only way I can have my say is if I put it in my own words, and that's why I started writing, and I see no harm in it. I mean, if the police don't like the books, the best thing to do is stop reading them, you know.
The entrepreneurial spirit that built Essex is building the legend of the Essex underworld. The Essex boys have entered criminal folklore, but one man wishes he'd killed the men before their legend was born.
Yeah, I do wish I killed them, and that is something I'll probably take to my grave, the fact that I didn't kill them, and the fact that I can't stand here and say, yeah, I did kill them, and I killed them slowly, and I tortured the pieces of They got off light for what they done to other families. I hope I meet up with them in hell.
From terror threats through to major advances in technology. A lot happened in the 2000s. Brand new, the decade we saw it all, is tomorrow at 10.
The SsangYong Tivoli comes with a 5-year limitless mileage warranty. Heated leather seats. 7-inch screen with reversing camera. It was chosen by Auto Express as the cheapest SUV to run. And now with 3 years free servicing.
Hi there.
Are you paying for other people's bad driving?
That's £53, please.
There's no excuse for that.
Hope you enjoyed the ride.
With the Aviva Drive app, safer drivers could save an average of £170 on our car insurance. Download the app now to see if you could save. Register today at Elite Singles and benefit from 100% verified profiles, an extensive personality test and tailored matches. EliteSingles.co.uk.
Experian know life is full of important steps. And now, Experian Credit Matcher helps you take a next step towards financial control. First, get your Experian credit score free forever. Then use Credit Matcher to find credit cards and loans you're more likely to be accepted for. Take the guesswork out of searching for credit cards and loans at experian.co.uk.
They daydream of the night before. See what happens when the sun goes down. Brand new Africa's Hunters, Monday at 8 on Nat Geo Wild.
Tomorrow, National Geographic will be looking back at 20 years of history, starting at 8 with the 80s, the decade that made us. Then at 9, we move forward 10 years to the 90s, the decade that connected us.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone home. She's gone.
Somebody better do the words.
As far as behavioral, I'm not a psychiatrist, but the feeling is different in a women's unit.
Come on, Miss Crockett. Staying out of trouble?
Of course. Why would I not?
I'm just asking.
I'm a good girl.
Okay.
Good girls stay out of trouble.
Really?
She a Vegas baby, and I beat her.
Bitch, I'm gonna go to prison anyway.
Women are different from men in that our crimes are crimes of passion or necessity. I don't care if we sell our butt. I don't care if we sell drugs. We will take care of our children. That is our job. Women take care of the house.
Watch it, hang on.
They feel this is their house. This is our house.
Let your mama raise you, because you don't want the police to raise you.
Now listen up. This is jail.
Before prison, offenders come to the jail. Some pray for a speedy release. Others already know they won't be going home anytime soon.